Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking about the accounting cycle, everything from journal entries to the post-closing trial balance and all the different steps in between. We've done lots of different examples of journal entries, preliminary closing entries, real closing entries, adjusting entries, etc. And then in our last segment, we introduced something that, while not part of the accounting cycle, is a crucial basic skill that we need to be comfortable with, and that is the ability to convert from accrual to cash or from cash to accrual. Now, as we said last time, it's an important skill since all businesses at some point are required to make these changes. If you're following GAAP, every single period you will have to take your accrual information and turn it into cash flow for at least a statement of cash flow statement required by GAAP. If you're a small company, mom and pop shop, you've been keeping track of everything using your checkbook, then you're going to have to eventually make the change from that cash information to more formal accrual accounting. Whether it's because an investor is requiring it, or because the regulator is requiring it, or because the bank is requiring it for a more significant loan, some point you're going to have to make this change. So with that said, at the end of our segment last time, we played around with some green water so that we were comfortable with the concept of cash flow and how changes in cash relate to the other accounts in our balance sheet. And if you remember, we talked about how as cash goes up, or other accounts, let me say it that way, as other accounts go up, cash goes down, the teeter-totter, right? Because as those accounts go down, cash typically goes up. And then we talked about the wave with liabilities and equity, where the change in one causes a similar change in the other. For example, if I pay off my taxes, the income tax account payable goes down, and so does my cash because I made a payment. So with those concepts, we're now ready to start talking about the actual worksheet and doing an example. So let's start the process by talking about the steps to doing a worksheet conversion. The very first step is to go through the balance sheet and use the shortcuts we've just talked about to find the cash effect of the change in all the balance sheet accounts. Now right now we're not going to worry about all the accounts in the balance sheet. We're just going to focus on a subset, those that help us to change a net income number into cash flow from operations, or that allow us to start from excess of cash disbursements over payments, which is the cash equivalent of net income, and turn it into net income. When we talk about the full-blown statement of cash flows, then we'll look at the whole picture. We can't do all the fun now, or we run out of stuff to talk about later. So, with that said, we're going to go through all of the balance sheet accounts that apply to the changes we're making. And then step two is to set up our worksheet. And the basic worksheet is going to look like this. We're going to start with our accrual information on the left. Then we're going to put our change in cash here in the middle. And finally, we're going to put the cash flow information here on the right. Now, technically, you can set this up any way you want to, and I have students that like to flip-flop, and whatever piece they know, they put it first, and they go to the other one. Personally, I recommend you always use this setup, because then it's very easy in one look to say, oh yeah, that's the equation that I need, because the equation changes. If I know my accrual information, then I take the accrual plus the change in cash to get to my cash flow. If, on the other hand, I know cash flow, then I subtract. I take the cash flow number minus the change to get back to my accruals. So the nice thing about the worksheet, if you leave it like this, it's easy to tell. If I have the left-hand side in the middle, then I add. If I have the right-hand side in the middle, then I subtract. Up to you, of course, but that's what I recommend to do. Once I've got my worksheet set up, then my next step is to put in the numbers that I know. I'll either know accrual numbers, and I put in that left-hand column, or I'll know the cash flow numbers, and I put in the right-hand column. Then I'll go back to step one and grab those numbers from the balance sheet and put them into my worksheet and match them up with the line items that make sense. Finally, step five, I'm going to complete the worksheet, either adding the change to the accruals or subtracting the change from the cash flows to get to the column that I'm really interested in. With that, let's take a look at an example. So right down below, you should see a link in the description here that allows you to go to a PDF of this example that we're going to do. Go ahead and download it, if you haven't already, and print it out. You should see something that looks like this. And we're going to start out by converting accruals to cash. There's two pages in your PDF. Make sure you get the right one. up and ready to go. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with this step one, which is to figure out the balance sheet changes. And you can see somehow I messed up my years here, and I feel bad about that. Oh well. The very first thing you want to check when you do this conversion is which year they've listed first. And companies do change it. Usually you see the older year on the right, and then on the left you see the newer year. But make sure you check. Now we're not going to worry about this for now. We'll use it when we do a full-blown statement of cash flow. We'll actually be looking for that change in cash. But for now, that's more than we need to talk about. So instead, let's jump right into the accounts that affect our net income. So the first one here is going to be accounts receivable. It's gone from $1,150 to $800. $350 change. Accounts receivable has gone down. If accounts receivable goes down, right? And I can't really do my teeter-totter. I don't have room here. If accounts receivable goes down, then cash goes up, right? So this is going to be a positive change in cash. Next, I'm going to look at interest receivable. Interest receivable matches up with interest revenue. So interest receivable has gone up. So cash goes down. And if you want to think about this another way, if you don't just want to memorize, hey, if it goes up, cash goes down, whatever, think about the most logical explanation. Accounts receivable probably went down because people have paid me what they owed me. If they paid me what they owed me, I have more cash. Interest receivable has gone up. The easiest explanation for that is that I have accrued interest, but they haven't sent me a check yet. If they haven't sent me the check, I have less cash in the bank. So the teeter-totter and the wave, they're just shortcuts that go through that same logical process. Inventory 2 matches up with my income statement. It has gone up $400, so cash goes down. Prepaid rent has gone down. If prepaid rent goes down, this one's a little bit less intuitive perhaps. If prepaid rent goes down, then I must have used up my prepaid rent instead of sending a check for this period, which means I have more cash on hand because I didn't have to pay this year. I paid it last year, so I have more cash now. So this is going to be a positive change. Now let's see, equipment, I don't buy equipment as part of my day-to-day operations. That's not going to match with my income statement, so I'm not going to worry about that for now. We will when we do a full statement of cash flows. Depreciation, I can use accumulated depreciation as a shortcut if I'm converting cash to accrual. In this case, I'm converting accruals to cash, so I don't need it. So this is not applicable at the moment either. Investments, again, I probably don't do that on a daily basis. It's not part of my operations, so I'm not going to worry about that. So those are my assets. Next, let's take a look at our liabilities. Let's see, accounts payable went up. If accounts payable went up, easiest explanation is that I haven't sent a check to my suppliers. If I haven't sent them a check, then I have more money in the bank. That's the wave. As the liability goes up, so does cash. Income tax payable goes down, so I must have sent the government a check. So I have a negative cash effect. Let's see, notes payable, that's long-term stuff. That's not going to be net income, so I'm not going to worry about that. The equity accounts, again, I'm not going to worry about them because, first of all, nothing changed. And second of all, that's not short-term stuff either. Wouldn't match with operations, and neither would retained earnings or dividends. Again, I'm specifically looking at the ones that change net income or affect net income, cash flow from operations, day-to-day stuff now. I'll deal with the others when we do the statement of cash flow. So that's step one. Step number two, I need to set up my worksheet. I'm going to put accruals here. I'm going to put the change in cash here. And my cash flows on this side. Now, I'm actually going to stop here for now. When we come back in our next segment, we will wrap up at least the next part of this example. We may not get through all of it, but we're going to keep moving forward on this example in our next segment. I'll see you then.